Jazallahu bil khayrati anna a'immatan lana naqalu al-Qur'ana 'azban wa salsala faminhum budurun sab'atun qad tawasatat sama' al-'ula wal-'adl zuhran wa kummala.
Now inshallah ta'ala, in this episode we're going to be speaking about the meaning of al-ahruf as-sab'ah. When the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said أنزل القرآن على سبعة أحرف, that the Qur'an was sent down in seven أحرف. What did the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mean by that? Before I go in to explaining the سبعة الأحرف السبعة, I want to do five things inshallah ta'ala that I believe is very important that the listeners and the viewers understand prior to commenting and explaining the views regarding al-ahruf al-sab'ah and whichever view is closest to the truth. The first point that inshallah ta'ala I want to clarify before going into the meaning is an al-qira'at al-sab'ah, that the seven qira'at that we have today, laysat hiya al-ahruf al-sab'ah, that it is not the seven ahruf. Okay? The seven qira'at that we have today with us, that we hear people recite in, that Al-Imam Ash-Shatibi mentions in his kitab, Al-Hirzu Al-Amani wa Wajhu Al-Tahani fi Al-Qira'at Al-Sab'ah, that he talks about the seven qira'at, the seven qira'at. These seven qira'at are not the seven ahruf that we will be talking about. And I'm going to mention five great imams saying this, inshallah ta'ala, yani pointing this out. The first imam is Makki ibn Abi Talib, rahimahullah, who died the year 337. He said, فَأَمَّا مَنْ ظَنَّ أَنَّ قِرَاءَةَ كُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِنْ هَؤُلَاءِ الْقُرَّاءِ كَنَافِعْ وَعَاصِمْ وَأَبِي عَمْرِ أَحَدُ الْأَحْرُفِ السَّبْعَةِ الَّتِي نَصَّ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم فَذَلِكَ مِنْهُ غَلَطٌ فَذَلِكَ مِنْهُ غَلَطٌ عَظِيمٌ إِذْ يَجِبُ أَنْ يَكُونَ مَا لَمْ يَقْرَأْ بِهِ هَؤُلَاءِ السَّبْعَةِ مَتْرُوكًا. Makki ibn Abi Talib, he said, whoever believes, or whoever thinks, أَنَّ قِرَاءَةَ كُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِنْ هَؤُلَاءِ الْقُرَّاءِ, that these seven reciters, يعني these seven قراء, يعني, and he gives an example, like Nafi' and Asim and Abi Amr, who are the seven قراء. He said, anyone who thinks that these seven qurra are ahadul al-ahruf al-sab'a, they think that each qari represents one ahruf, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated in the hadith, فَذَلِكَ مِنْ وَلَطٌ, this person is mistaken. Because by saying that, right, for example, if you say Nafi'z qira'ah is one harf, Asim's one is another harf, Abu Amr is another harf, and then you count the seven qurra and each qari, you make it one harf. So what you're in essence saying is that these seven qurra are the only ahruf, that they are the only ahruf, and anyone other than these seven, their recitations can be abandoned and left. And we know the qira'at are not just seven, they're more than seven. There are 10. And I mentioned previously, Abu Ubaid al-Qasim al-Sallam mentioned 25 qira'at in his kitab. So that's what you're saying in essence. If you say that the seven qira'at are the seven ahruf that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated. Abu al-Abbas al-Mahdawi, who died the year 440 Hijriah, this is the second imam. He says, لَقَدْ فَعَلَ مُسَبِّعُ السَّبْعَةَ مَا لَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ وأشكل الأمر على العامة بإيهامه كل من قل نظره أن هذه القراءات هي المذكورة في الخبر وليته إذ اقتصر نقص على السبعة أو زاد ليزيل الشبهة. أبو العباس المهدوي, who died in 440 Hijriah, he says that this issue of people thinking that the seven قراءات is seven أحرف, he said this comes from an imam by the name of Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid. This mistake came from who? Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid. Why? He authored a book where he called it As-Sab'ah. And so people, when they saw this book of his, and this book was of course in Qira'at, They thought that the qira'at and the ahruf al-sab'a are the same. So he made this ambiguity or vagueness or even confusion come to the general mass because of his doings. And then he said, rahimahullah, وَلَيْتُ إِذْ اِقْتَصَرَ نَقَصَ عَلَى السَّبْعَ. Why didn't he either reduce and make it six so that it doesn't confuse the people? Or why didn't he at least add an extra one and make it eight? لِيُزِيلَ الشُّبْهَ, so he can remove this doubt from the hearts of the people. يعني make it eight like Ibn Ghalbun did, rahimahullah. Abu al-Hasan Ibn Ghalbun. Ibn Ghalbun, he wrote a kitab called At-Tadkira fi al-Qira'at al-Thaman. He made it eight so he doesn't confuse the people. The third imam is Abu Shamah al-Maqdisi rahimahullah. Abu Shamah rahimahullah, he said, وَقَدْ ظَنَّ جَمَاعَةٌ مِمَّنْ لَا خِبْرَةَ لَهُ بِأُصُولِ هَذَا الْعِلْمِ أَنَّ قِرَاءَاتَ هَؤُلَاءِ الْأَئِمَّةِ السَّبْعَةِ هِيَ الَّتِي عَبَّرَ عَنْهَا النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ بِقَوْلِهِ أُنْزِلَ الْقُرْآنُ عَلَى سَبْعَةِ أَحْرُفٍ فَقِرَاءَةُ كُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِنْ هَؤُلَاءِ حَرْفٍ مِنْ تِلْكَ الْأَحْرُفِ وَلَقَدْ أَخْطَأَ مَنْ نَسَبَ إِلَى ابْنِ مُجَاهِدٍ أَنَّهُ قَالَ ذَلِكَ. Abu Shamah said that a group of people who have no understanding or deep comprehension of these, the science of ulumul Qur'an and qira'at, and people who don't know this, they thought that the seven qira'at that we have today are the seven ahruf that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was referring to in the hadith, unzil al-Qur'anu ala sab'ati ahruf. And so what they thought was each qari is one harf of the seven that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. And he also clarified that it's wrong on behalf of those who think that to attribute this view to Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid, to say Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid said that the seven qira'at are the seven ahruf. He said they're wrong and they're mistaken, because all Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid really did was he wrote a book in qira'at and he mentioned seven qira'at, and it happened to be the same number as the ahruf that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, salawatullahi wasalamun alayhi. Now I'm going to mention the fourth imam is Ibn al-Jazari rahimahullah. Ibn al-Jazari, who died the year 833 Hijriah, he said, لا يجوز, it is not permissible, أن يكون المراد هؤلاء السبعة القراء المشهورين وإن كان يظنه بعض العوام لأن هؤلاء السبعة لم يكونوا خلقوا ولا وجدوا. Ibn al-Jazari rahimahullah, he said, لا يجوز, it is not permissible, أن يكون المراد هؤلاء السبعة القراء المشهورين وإن كان يظنه بعض العوام. It is not permissible that the intent behind the hadith أنزل القرآن على سبعة أحرف, to assume that it's referring to these famous قراء, the seven great قراء, that is referring to them. It is a mistaken belief. It's a error on the side of the person who thinks that. وإن كان يظنه بعض العوام. And the scholars, what you tend to see is that they refer to the people who think that the qira'at al-sab'a and the ahruf al-sab'a are the same. They refer to them as what? Awam, the general mass. And they're not scholars and they're not students of knowledge. لأن هؤلاء السبعة لم يكونوا خلقوا ولا وجدوا. Because if you say that the sab'at ahruf are the qira'at al-sab'a, then when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was saying the seven ahruf, these seven qurra weren't even alive. They weren't created yet. They didn't come into existence, Ibn al-Jazari rahimahullah says. The earliest of them all is Ibn Amir, Imam Ahl al-Sham. Ibn Amir was the earliest. They said he was born on the 21st year of the Hijriya rahimahullah. And Imam al-Shatibi rahimahullah, he said, وَأَمَّا دِمَشْقُ الشَّامِ دَارُ بْنُ عَامِرٍ فَتِلْكَ بِعَبْدِ اللَّهِ طَابَتْ مُحَلَّلًا. And Imam Ibn Amir was Imam Ahl al-Sham. He was Imam Ahl al-Sham. So he was the earliest, and he was a student of Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The best student Abu Darda had in Quran was Ibn Amir rahimahullah. So he was the earliest, and even he wasn't at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Saying that the qira'at al-sab' is the ahruf al-sab' is a fallacy, it's a mistaken belief, and it's an error. Finally, the fifth and final imam I want to mention is none other than Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. Ibn Taymiyyah, he said, فَتَبَيَّنَ بِمَا ذَكَرْنَاهُ أَنَّ الْقِرَاءَاتِ الْمَنْسُوبَةِ إِلَى نَافِعْ وَعَاصِمْ هِيَ الْأَحْرُفِ السَّبْعَةِ الَّتِي أُنزِلَ الْقُرْآنُ عَلَيْهَا وَذَلِكَ بِاتِّفَاقِ عُلَمَاءِ السَّلَفِ وَالْخَلَفِ. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said, it has become clear, as we had mentioned, أن القراءات السبع تنافع أن عاصم هي الأحرف السبعة, to say that it is the seven أحرف that the Qur'an was sent down, is a mistaken belief. It's wrong. And that is by consensus of the ulama of the Salaf and the Khalaf. So the scholars, they excused Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid for four reasons. They mentioned four reasons to excuse Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid in doing such a thing. The first reason, the first excuse they gave for him was that he authored these seven qira'at in accordance to the shuyukh he took from. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala facilitated for Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid to be able to take the Qur'an in these seven qira'at, and he didn't get more. And the shuyukh he received the Qur'an from were these seven qira'at. And so the seven, by the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, happened to be the seven of the ahruf al-sab'ah. So this was in accordance to his chains of qira'at. It was just seven. It happened to be seven. And the ahruf al-sab'ah happened to be seven. And that's where the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came about. So this, they say, this adad is just muwafaqah. It just agreed with one another. I hope that is clear. The second, inshallah ta'ala, is he authored these seven deliberately in accordance to the ahruf al-sab'ah. He did it deliberately. Yani these seven qira'at, he chose them. He had more than this. He had more than seven. So again, this is contrary to the first view. It's in opposition to the first view. I mean, the first excuse that was given for him. The second view, second excuse is that he did it, these seven, because he wanted tabarruk and tayammun. He was looking for barakah. The Prophet said seven here, and he selected seven. And it wasn't to say to the people that these seven are these seven. But he saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned seven here, and he thought, why not make a qira'at and choose seven of them? And he selected and he chose seven of those qira'at and authored a book in it. This view, Shihabuddin al-Qastalani and Abu Shamat al-Maqdisi both said this was the reason why he did it. The third excuse that some scholars give is, or the reasoning of why he did it, is that they said the masahif that Uthman radiallahu anhu, he sent it to the Amsar, the lands that he sent it to were seven places, seven cities, seven main cities that Uthman radiallahu anhu sent it to. There's a view that says it was seven. And Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid, what he did was, he rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah, he wanted to make the qira'at in accordance to those seven. That's a view that some scholars have said. So again, he's not in any way, shape or form trying to say that the qira'at al-sab'ah and the ahruf al-sab'ah are both the same. He's not saying in any way, shape or form. The fourth reason, the fourth excuse or the fourth explanation that the scholars have given and put forward is that أَنَّهُ لَا يُؤَخَذُ عَالِمٌ كَبْنُ مُجَاهِدٍ بِفَهْمِ الْعَوَامِ. That we can't hold Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid account for the ignorance of the general mass and say that the people understood it like this, so it's your fault. We cannot fault him because of the people's understanding. He's a scholar, he's an imam, he's entitled to choose whatever number he likes, and it's upon the general mass and the people to study their religion and understand it. So those four reasons are the i'tidarat, the excuses that the scholars have put forward to explain his reasoning and why he did it, rahimahullah ta'ala. So I've mentioned the first point that I said I wanted to go through before I go and indulge and clarify and comment on the meaning of the ahruf al-sab'ah. I've clarified one point, I hope so, which is that the seven qira'at are not the seven ahruf. I hope I've clarified that for you all. The second point I want to mention is the ahruf al-sab'ah, the ahadith that have come regarding it, the ahadiths that have come regarding it have reached a level in ilm al-hadith known as mutawatir. It has reached mass transmission, multitude narration, mass transmission. It's mutawatir. And when we say that a hadith reaches mutawatir, it means that it benefits our certainty. It's no longer speculation and assumption. It's now based on certainty. Then the hadith related to al-ahruf al-sab'a is mutawatir. And the scholars that mention that it's mutawatir are a lot, but I'm only going to mention three. The first one is al-imam Abu Ubaid al-Qasim ibn Salam, who died the year 224 Hijriah. He said it's mutawatir. The second imam I'm going to mention is al-imam Abu Amr al-Dani, who died the year 444 Hijriah. He clearly and categorically stated that the hadith al-ahruf al-sab'a have reached tawatur, multitude narration, mass transmission. The last and final imam that I'm going to mention, which is the third, is Ibn al-Qasih, who died the year 801 Hijriah. He said that the hadiths al-ahruf al-sab'a are mutawatir. The third, inshallah ta'ala, point that I want to bring to your attention before I explain what it means al-ahruf al-sab'a is this hadith al-ahruf al-sab'a that we have and we see is not a matter that we Muslims are hiding and that we're trying to throw a wool over the people's eyes and hide it from them, and it's only mentioned in private circles. No. Books have been written on it. And these books have become volumes. And if you bring them together, they're volumes. They're hundreds of pages, thousands of pages from the Muslims. It's not that orientalists and the non-Muslims are the ones who brought it out. I'm going to give you some books that have been written on it for you to understand that this is not something that the Muslims are hiding. It's something you can research. These books, you can download them online and read about it. And it also, inshallah ta'ala, what I want to bring to your attention is that I will not be able to go over this topic in great details as I would love to. The reason, because it's thousands of books. We're talking about hundreds of books that have been written on it. Yani, I will say to you, there is not a book that talks about ulum al-Qur'an, except there is a chapter in there that speaks about al-ahruf al-sab'a. Every book of ulum al-Qur'an that you get, al-ahruf al-sab'a is mentioned in there. But I'm not mentioning those books. I'm mentioning books that have specifically been written on just al-ahruf al-sab'a. And if I count and I mention the other books that have in their chapters related to al-ahruf al-sab'a, then I would mention Bukhari, which brings it, Muslim, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i, Muslim Ahmad, Muslim al-Tayalisi, Musannaf ibn Abi Shaybah. I'll mention all of the Dawawin al-Sunnah. All of them state the hadith. But I'm talking about books that have been specifically been written on it. The first one is Abu Ubaid al-Qasim al-Sallam. He has a book on the al-ahruf al-sab'a. Ibn Qutaybah, rahimahullah, who died the year 276 Hijriah. He has a kitab on al-ahruf al-sab'a. We have al-imam Abu al-Fadl al-Razi, who died the year 454 Hijriah. He has a kitab on al-ahruf al-sab'a. Al-Imam Abu Shamat al-Maqdisi, he has written a book on al-ahruf al-sab'a. Al-Imam Ibn al-Jazari, rahimahullah, he has a kitab on al-ahruf al-sab'a. Al-Shaykh Muhammad Bakhit al-Muti'i, who died the year 1354 Hijriah, has written a book on it. These are all the mutaqaddimin, the early people, the early scholars. Let me now mention the mutaakhirin, some of those who are still alive and recent books that have been written on it. Dr. Abdul Aziz Al-Qari, who is the Amid Kulliyati Al-Hadith, I think, in Jami' Islamiyah, he has written a book on it. Dr. Hassan Diyauddin Itr, he has a research, Risala Ilmiya, he has written on Al-Ahruf Al-Sab'a. So, two things it benefits us, these works. Number one, the Muslims are not hiding anything. It's available for anybody to read. Number two, it's not something that can be tackled in an episode or two. It's something that requires lengthy episodes, each one that 2-3 hours, and four like hundreds of parts, which inshallah ta'ala I wouldn't be able to do. So I'm just going to give you the khulas, inshallah ta'ala, the summary. And it's upon you viewers and listeners to go furthermore and read about it, inshallah ta'ala. The fourth one is al-ikhtilaf. There are differences of opinion regarding al-ahruf al-sab'a. Yes, we agree there are. There is khilaf, there are differences of opinion. The views are not all united. The Muslims have differed in this issue. I'm going to mention some of the Imams stating this. Al-Imam ibn al-Arabi rahimahullah al-Maliki, the great Maliki scholar, he said, لَمْ يَأْتِي فِي مَعْنَى هَذِهِ السَّبْعَ. These seven, يعني سبعة, الأحرف السبعة, الأحرف السبعة, there hasn't come, he said, نَصٌ وَلَا أَثَر. There's no textual evidence or even any proof that we have from the Prophet or even the companions that explains to us what this al-ahruf al-sab'a means. We don't. وَاخْتَلَفَ النَّاسُ فِي تَعْيِينِهَا. And because of it, the scholars differed regarding it. Because there's no nas and there's no athar, difference of opinion occurred. I'm going to mention, inshallah ta'ala, there are two reasons why this whole issue, there is difference of opinion. One of them, Ibn al-Arabi just told you now, which is there is no nas and there is no athar in this situation. I remember we Muslims, when we differ on a matter, what were we commanded to do? We were told that if we differ, وَمَا اخْتَلَفْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَحُكْمُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. If you differ upon one another in a matter, then Allah and His Messenger are going to judge between you. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ فَإِنْ تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. That if you differ in a matter and you disagree in a matter, we were instructed to go back to the Qur'an and the Sunnah. So this issue of al-ahruf al-sab'a, we don't have a nas or an athar to go back to. That's why the difference of opinion occurred. That's one reason. The second reason why, I'm going to mention inshallah ta'ala in our next episode, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. The second reason why there is a difference of opinion. Al-Imam Jalaluddin al-Suyuti mentioned, he said, اختلف في معنى هذا الحديث. This hadith, al-ahruf al-sab'a, he said there's a difference of opinion regarding it. على نحو من 40 قولا, 40 views. يعني السيوطي, جلال الدين السيوطي is saying, after he looked at it and he researched and he observed and he looked and he looked, he said, رحمه الله, there are 40 views regarding al-ahruf al-sab'a. Mullah Ali Qari came and what did he do? He made it, after السيوطي he came. He made it how many views? He made it 41 views. So he added an extra view onto the issue. Ibn Hibban, what did he say? He said, اختلف أهل العلم في معنى الأحرف السبعة على 35 قولا. Ibn Hibban, at his time, there was 35 views. Suyuti said, it's 40. Mullah Ali Qari came, he made it 41. This issue has become so disagreed upon that Ibn al-Jazari, Imam هذا الفن, the Imam of this field, what did he say? Rahimahullah. He said, ما زلت أستشكل هذا الحديث وأفكر فيه وأمعن النظر من نيف وثلاثين سنة حتى فتح الله علي بما يمكن أن يكون صوابا إن شاء الله. Ibn al-Jazari, Rahimahullah, he said, this hadith has truly confused me and has become very vague and ambiguous for me. He said, I thought about it. I pondered over it. I contemplated over it. I looked at it multiple times, he said. For how long? 30-something years I've been looking at it. After that, what did he say? حَتَّى فَتَحَ اللَّهُ عَلَيَّ. Until Allah opened for me. بِمَا يُمْكِنُ. Look what he said. بِمَا يُمْكِنُ. أن يكون صوابا إن شاء الله. That which I hope, he said, that it will be the correct view if Allah wills. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah came after that, the great scholar, Shaykh al-Islam, Ibn Taymiyyah. He said, هذه مسألة كبيرة. This, first of all, الأحرف السبعة is a very, very complicated issue. تَكَلَّمَ فِيهَا أَصْنَافُ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Many scholars have spoken about it, have discussed it. He said, مِنَ الْفُقَهَاءِ, the scholars, وَالْقُرَّاءِ, and the scholars of qira'at, وَأَهْلِ الْحَدِيثِ وَالْكَلَامِ, and the scholars of hadith, and the scholars of عِلْمُ الْكَلَامِ, وَشَرْحِ الْغَرِيبِ وَغَيْرِهِمْ, and the scholars who've looked at strange words, يعني غريب الألفاظ. Yeah, this word is strange, what does it mean? He's saying the fuqaha looked at this hadith. The qurra looked at this hadith. The ahlul hadith, they looked at this hadith. Ahlul kalam, they looked at this hadith. The scholars of the language, who the dictionaries, they also tried to look at this hadith. All of these people looked at it. It was a matter that all of the sciences did not hold back. Everybody threw what they could say about it. This, by the way, brothers and sisters, shows us something very important, which is our scholars, their sincerity and their honesty. If they didn't know something, they would say, I don't know. It also shows us how they didn't hold back in trying to look at the hadith and understand it and digest it. Number five, this point I think is very important that every single person understands this. Which is, after I mentioned the difference of opinion, some of you might be taken back and say, whoa, you just mentioned Ibn Jazari. You just mentioned Jalaluddin al-Suyuti. You mentioned Ibn al-Arabi. You mentioned Ibn Hibban. You mentioned Ibn Taymiyyah. You know, like, if these people were saying that this is complicated, how would you be able to give us the strongest opinion? And how will this ever be resolved? What I want to say to you, brothers and sisters who are watching, who are viewing this episode, is that the ambiguity and the difference in the meaning of this hadith has nothing to do with the preservation. It has nothing to do with the preservation of the Qur'an. It's got to do with the meaning of this hadith and what is understood from it. That's it. Nothing more, nothing less. None of those imams that I mentioned looked at this hadith and said, I'm questioning the preservation of the Qur'an. The Qur'an is not preserved. Because of the fact that this hadith is not understood properly, or the confusion in this hadith, because of it, I believe the Qur'an is not preserved. None of them said that. They said, the confusion is regarding what this hadith means. I also want to say to you, brothers and sisters, that the Sahabas knew what it meant. The Sahabas, Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, they knew what it meant. Because the hadith I mentioned to you, Al-Ahruf al-Sab'ah, is mutawatir, multitude narration. When Umar radiallahu anhu and the mukhasama, the dispute, the argumentation that took place between Umar radiallahu anhu and Hisham ibn Hakim, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them both that the Qur'an came down in seven Ahruf, it was to judge between the two of them, that what you read is right, and what you read was right. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him that the Qur'an was sent down in seven ahruf. Umar understood that what seven ahruf meant. And Hisham and Hakim understood it. Because the Prophet was judging between the two of them. If they didn't understand, Umar would have said, Ya Rasulallah, I don't know how that works. Hisham is reading it wrong. You said there's seven ahruf. What do you mean by seven ahruf? Umar would have asked if he didn't understand. Hisham and Hakim would have asked if he didn't understand. Rather, if you look at the narration Al-Imam Ahmad mentioned in his Musnad, that Ubay radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he heard a recitation being recited, it confused him, he started to have a doubt. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after that, told Ubay radiallahu ta'ala, after that he told him, Ubay, the Qur'an has been sent down in seven ahruf. In seven ahruf. Ubay radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the doubt that was in his heart left. When the Prophet ﷺ hit him in the chest, the doubt left his heart. And Ubay was told that this different recitations you're hearing is all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's the seven ahruf. Ubay didn't look at the Prophet and say, Ya Rasulullah, I'm still confused. I don't know what you're saying. He understood what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was saying. Because the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, in many of the ahadiths, what we see from them is that when the Messenger says something, they said, Ya Rasulullah, what is this? They question him. They ask him in order to know more. The people who the ambiguity came to and were not able to understand what the al-ahruf al-sab'ah meant is those who came after the Sahabas. They were the ones who became confused by it and didn't understand it. I already mentioned to you one reason why they didn't understand. The people who came after didn't understand it. Because there's no narration. There is no narration what the Ahruf al-Sab'ah means. There is no narration. And this is another thing. Why did the Sahabas not transmit something? Because the hadith I just said is mutawatir, multitude narration. Why did not one companion say, this is what's meant by it? The reason why they didn't is because it was known by necessity. It was something that was well known. They didn't think it required explanation. And I'm going to, inshallah ta'ala, expand on that more when we go into the meaning of al-ahruf al-sab'ah. Those 5 points, keep it in your mind. As we go through the views that are out there, things will become clear, inshallah ta'ala, for you. I'm going to stop here for now, and I'll see you guys in the next episode, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. Jazakumullah khairan for listening. Wa barakallahu feekum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How can you do a 2-second action right now that will give you a share of the reward of everything we're doing on this YouTube channel? Simple. Like this video and click subscribe. Why? It will allow YouTube to recommend our videos to other users. And imagine the huge amount of reward that could be waiting for you on the Day of Judgment if you did that with a sincere intention of spreading the Deen of Allah. You'll be rewarded for every single person who benefits from one of our videos as a result of your like or subscribe. That's an easy 2-second action that you definitely don't want to miss out on. Do it now, click like and subscribe, and don't forget to make that intention.